The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host or guest and should not be interpreted as statement of fact. Independent fact-checking and corrections are encouraged.
Can we get a cup of coffee in here, please?
Hot.
Wake up, America. You've got a dog that needs walking. That's right, sunshine. Just put on a big pot of strong coffee and get ready to type your little hate mail with your opinions about kumbaya and flat earth insanity. Stand-up comedy? You want stand-up comedy? Well, we've got sit-down comedy. It's time for Coffee with a Dog. You make me laugh.
Oh, whoa, whoa. Everyone is gay. That is the story for today. Everyone is gay. Not me. And not that there's anything wrong with me. But, and the man is very gay, because they never know when to stop, and that is a sign that you're gay. Anyway, good morning, folks. It is Wednesday, September 13th, 2023. Forgot what week, what month, what year, all of that stuff. Anyway, I hope it's a wonderful day where you are. Just in the news today, Matt Schlapp, Republican pundit, who has been accused of sexually molesting an aide to him, is accusing Tim Scott, a presidential candidate, of being gay. The Republican Party is hung up on gayness big time. I mean, Obama's gay, Tim Scott's gay, Matt Schlapp is gay. Everybody accusing everybody of being gay, except for Lindsey Graham. It really shouldn't matter at this point. We're 2023. Tim Scott is claiming he has a girlfriend. Now, nobody has been able to locate his girlfriend. He's in denial. Listen, the people who want to outlaw homosexuality are the ones in the closet. It seems that way anyway. It's just crazy how the gay finger pointing, you're gay, you're gay, you're gay. No, you're gay. I'm gay, you're gay. And I'm thinking of Kurt Cobain. Everyone is gay. Except me. I'm not. Listen, I would be if I could be. I mean, it's a better way to live. You have your partner there. You can, I don't know, share clothes and all that kind of stuff. You don't have to listen to the wife yapping, blah, 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 blah. It's probably a better way to live. I just can't do it, because I'm allergic to cock. Now, that's not why I'm sneezing this morning. I just want you to know. So we'll start out with that for you this morning. We will have a author by the name of Jim Lichtman here today. He's going to be talking about his book called Truth and Confidence. It's a tale of the Ken Starr investigation into Monica Lewinsky and Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton and Monica Lewinsky. I mean, she was a kid at the time. Well, I don't know why I put her first. Because of trying to get her on the program for a long time. She doesn't do interviews and stuff. I think Monica Lewinsky is a fascinating person. I need a little more coffee. Hold on a second. But I've been trying to get her on the program for as long as I've been doing this. She's not interested. Maybe she will be. Don't let Jordan Peterson in the show today. He cannot come into the show. So I'll keep Jordan out. He likes to enter through my vocal cords sometimes. Monica Lewinsky is a very fascinating person. I mean, what she's done with her life, with the anti-bullying stuff, got to give her a lot of credit. Listen, think about this. 22 years old. Forget that what she's famous for. Forget the sexual images you have in your mind and the blue dress and all. Forget the things I just told you about that it makes it even harder for you to forget that. 22-year-old intern. Who wouldn't want that dream job of starting out your first real thing out of college, your first real thing is to be an aide to the president, an intern to the president of the United States. You're on a high. Then all of a sudden, he's a powerful man, and you're an impressionable young woman looking for love in all the right places, like all young women are. And the president comes on to you, and he says, I don't really love my wife. It's just a marriage of convenience. And he leads her on like an old man would do to a 22-year-old girl, making her think that she might be the next Mrs. Clinton. Now, she does not play the victim, and I'll get to that. And I think she's still a Bill Clinton supporter, which is insane to me. Because this man kind of really, he gave her an opportunity, and then he abused her and used her. But she doesn't see it that way. Anyway, so, you know, all the people dumping on her, when the stuff came out, she became the butt of mouth of every joke for about 2 years in America. Every joke was about the blue dress, cum stains, his crooked dick, and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, as a young person, you'd want to go hide in that situation. You know, everybody is making jokes about you and your affair with the president of the United States. You're just going to want to go hide and not see anybody. And so I give her credit for becoming an advocate against bullies and all that kind of stuff. It had to have been a difficult life. And the fact that she remains empathetic, sympathetic, and kind of still loyal to the Clintons blows my mind. It blows my mind. She is somebody who, like Bill Clinton, didn't give a when he pointed his finger at us and the press, saying he didn't have sex with that woman, Ms. Lewinsky, he was making her the bad guy. Like, you know, the disdain in his voice when he said her name. And again, this is a kid, 22-year-old intern, thinking she's got a shot at, I don't know, stealing the president again out of a an unhappy marriage, or whatever she was thinking. I don't know. But he's definitely, there's a extreme power dynamic there. The president of the United States, not just an older man, an older, more experienced man, and a young girl. This is the president of the United States and a kid right out of college, an intern. I would love to have her on the program. I've reached out to her a dozen times and never gotten a response. Maybe after today, maybe she'll be interested in coming on. I don't want to belabor the point. In the second hour today, we will have Craig Mitchell, who is the host of Off the Cuff Cooking. He's a former stand-up comedian. I don't think he can be. It's like a Marine. You're not a former Marine. You're once a Marine, you're always a Marine. Once a comedian, you're always a comedian. He hosts a comedy cooking show called Off the Cuff Cooking. It's a low carb cooking. He was diagnosed with diabetes 2 several years ago. Had a problem with, you know, a big problem with weight and that kind of stuff. So now he's doing this show called Off the Cuff Cooking. It's about to have its sixth season, about to premiere, I believe, tonight. So we'll talk to Craig in the second hour. And it should be a fun show. And we'll get to learn some stuff about Ken Starr, and you know what, maybe set the record straight. I have some questions about whether the public, you, me, and the guy next door, really give a damn about anything factual based. We just care about headlines. And that's pretty clear. I mean, headlines are, people don't read the stories. And I caught myself doing it this morning. There was a thing in, I don't know if it's Atlantic, something about the origins of life might not be in Africa. And there's this long article, and I'm scanning through it because I just want to find out where they're saying life began rather than Africa. And I couldn't do it. It was just long, lots of ads and all that kind of stuff. So purposely keeping the lead buried as far as it could be, so you'd have to read the entire thing. And I got exhausted. I don't care about the method scientists use to figure out mitochondrial DNA tracking and all that stuff. I just want to know where you're saying human life began other than Africa. I never got to it. I got bored and I bailed. Okay. Not to bury our lead, Willie will be here with the news later, I believe. And he's going to be talking about, you know, he has been talking about this Daniello Cavalcante, the escaped convict in Pennsylvania. He has been apprehended. It looks like National Guard. It doesn't look like cops. We'll get to the story. Maybe, I'm sure Willie knows more than I do about this. But it looks like they gave the guy a little tune-up. Or as they say in Brooklyn, gave him a little tune-up. Beat him up quite a bit. And you can understand them being careful, because he was presumed armed and dangerous. He was a murderer. He is a murderer. But it seems like they might have went, you know, gave him a few extras just for making him look stupid for the last 2 weeks. Anyway, we'll hear from Willie with the news, and it should be a fun show. It should be. If I could just keep Jordan Peterson out of my vocal cords, things will be cool. We're going to meet our first guest in just a moment. Right now, I want to tell you that we are sponsored today by True Fire. True Fire is the best place to learn guitar online. You know, we were talking with the subject yesterday was ageism and how people sometimes want to do things, but they keep putting it off. Keep putting it off. And then you get to the end of your life and you say, I wish I would have. And so, don't wait till it's too late. You can learn to play guitar now at any age. And the best place to do that is True Fire. We could be back in just a moment. One, two.
Over 2 million guitar players worldwide learn, practice, and play with True Fire. Our learning tools and massive library of video lessons will ignite your technical skills, harmonic knowledge, rhythm playing, and soloing chops. True Fire's educators are the best in the biz, from Grammy Award winners to world-renowned artists. You'll have access to an unparalleled faculty of over 300 top-notch blues, rock, jazz, country, fingerstyle, and acoustic guitar educators. Using our desktop and mobile apps, you'll work with True Fire's multi-angle video lessons on any device, anytime, anywhere. Integrated learning tools such as video synced tab and notation, slow-mo, looping, practice jam tracks, and many more handy controls accelerate your learning experience. True Fire style-specific learning paths guide you every step of the way. Use our assessment tools to find your starting point, then follow our lesson recommendations, and track your progress as you work through your personalized True Fire study plan. Progress faster with private one-on-one instruction, group lessons, multi-track video jams, live streams, song lessons, student forums, True Fire's Riff magazine, premium jam tracks, and much, much more. With thousands of 5-star ratings and reviews from amateur and pro players alike, you'll find yourself in good company with the world's most comprehensive guitar learning platform. Grab your guitar and ignite your musicality. Sign up free for an all-access trial today.
inviting music. I would like to cordially invite musicality to come to me, because for 65 years I've been pursuing it, and I got none. Anyway, we're about to meet our first guest today. Jim Lichtman has been writing and speaking on ethics since 1995. He's got a new book out called, or I don't know if it's out yet, actually. It says coming soon on the website, which is trustandconfidencebook.com. I believe it's due out any day now. It's about Ken Starr's investigation into the affair between Bill Clinton and Monica Lewinsky, and how the Secret Service got involved in a clash between Ken Starr and the Secret Service. He's here now waiting.
Hey, Matt.
Good morning.
Good morning. Can you hear me okay?
I can.
Okay.
Anyway, I'll deal with it. This book now. Why did you feel compelled to write this book now, 25 years after the scandal?
Well, actually, I had done an interview with Director Louis Merletti, the former Secret Service director at the time, and he told me this story while I was sitting in his office in Cleveland, Ohio. And for the purpose of your viewers that don't know, in 1998, the Clinton-Lewinsky scandal was all over the headlines every single day. That's all we heard. Well, Merletti told me this story about how independent counsel Ken Starr wanted to compel agents on the president's protective detail to testify in open court about what they may have seen or heard regarding Clinton's affair with Monica Lewinsky. Well, Merletti argued that having agents testify about personal conversations, except for criminal conduct, would violate the trust and confidence level that is necessary for agents to do their job. They have to have proximity. And if they were, if the president learned that they were testifying in court or talking about private conversations, the president would essentially push protection away, leaving him vulnerable to assassination. So that's what the people knew at the time. That's what was reported in news accounts. However, what the public did not know is that behind the scenes, independent counsel Ken Starr relied on an anonymous source inside the Secret Service who alleged that Merletti was secretly facilitating the Clinton-Lewinsky relationship by going to the White House at night, taking Clinton out of the White House, putting him in the back seat of a car, covering him with a blanket, and driving him to a hotel to meet with Lewinsky. Whoa. And the deal that he had with Clinton was, keep quiet about Lewinsky and I'll make you the next director of the Secret Service. Now, all of this was completely false. It was part of one individual's point to bring down Louis Merletti. And this was never reported in the news. When I sat down with Merletti in his Cleveland office, I was just astonished at hearing this story. But Ken Starr, without any corroboration from anybody, and they spent hundreds and hundreds of man hours looking to see if this source was true, this is what he told me, and that's what led me to write the book, because I'd never heard this story of something that turned out to be one of the best stories of integrity I've ever heard, because he stood up to Ken Starr, told the truth repeatedly, and would not cave in.
That's insane. Now, first of all, because as you were saying, the accusation, I'm assuming it's true already, and this is human nature. You're just setting it up. And I'm hearing that Merletti is taking Clinton out to a car and throwing a blanket over. The idea of the president getting in the back of a limo and being snuck in like a drive-in movie theater type of operation.
Right.
It's just an insane kind of picture in my head. And then I was relieved to hear that it was all made up. The question is, did Starr believe it or just really wanted to believe it and wanted to? Because it seems like he wanted to, right from the get-go, create this this because they couldn't get him for Whitewater and they couldn't get him for Vince Foster and Travelgate and all that kind of stuff. They just wanted to get him on something, and that was the motivation here. Do you think Ken Starr actually believed that one witness who was against Belletti?
I don't know if he actually believed it, but certainly his prosecutors believed it. And it was just amazing to me because a special counsel I spoke with several times who was investigating the Lewinsky confrontation at the Ritz-Carlton said that Ken Starr was completely out of his depth. He had no idea what was going on, how to handle this, how to handle an independent counsel's office, because he had no previous experience as a federal prosecutor. And so as a result, Joanne Harris told me that he just let his staff more or less lead him around. He was interested in the legal aspects of it, but he allowed himself to believe this, it appears, and according to the testimony that I found. Wow. And that's what supposedly happened. I had talked to two former prosecutors in Starr's office, and I mentioned this story to them, and they never denied. They said, well, we're aware of the allegation. And I said, but you didn't come up with anything. No, but that doesn't mean something didn't happen. We may have not had the right Secret Service agents to testify about this, to tell us that this happened. And I told one prosecutor, but you spoke to 33 agents. And anyway, they lost case after case in court because what Merletti, the Secret Service director, was fighting for was a protective privilege that would prevent Ken Starr or anyone else bringing agents into a court and testifying. They took this case all the way to the Supreme Court, and ultimately they lost because there was no law at the time to cover this. Even though it fit with the premise that we have where there is attorney-client privilege, there is doctor-patient privilege, there are all kinds of these things that where people can't reveal confidences, and yet he lost this case.
Interesting. It's so interesting. Now, I'm at that time, I was going through a lot in my life, and I don't remember the detail, because it would seem that Starr would have benefited greatly in his effort if he would have made that story about Merletti sneaking out and throwing a towel over Clinton in the back seat of a limo. If that would have made public, that was never made public, right?
Never made public. And not, you know, something like that happening today, that people would find out about that. That would be all over the headlines too.
Absolutely. Now, did you come away with an opinion of Starr as a person? Was he doing this at a personal ambition, or was he a true believer in the cause that, oh my God, this is the worst crime anybody could ever commit, is getting a blowjob from a 22-year-old in the Oval Office?
Well, I believe that Ken Starr acted in good faith when he took on the job. He was appointed by the special division, which was the panel that oversaw the independent counsel. And he replaced, a lot of people may not know this, but he replaced Robert Fisk, who was the regulatory independent counsel. And so when the independent counsel statute was renewed by Congress, they took Fisk out of the position. It was already in his investigation for some 6 months or so. And the replaced, who was, by the way, a federal prosecutor, had plenty of experience. And they appointed Ken Starr, who was a judge with no experience in this. I think he came in as an honest broker, but he was simply overwhelmed by everything. And as a result, according to Joanne Harris, the special counsel I interviewed numerous times, she said he was over his head. And he just, you know, followed what his prosecutors were laying out. And I'm assuming he believed some of this stuff. Otherwise, he wouldn't have operated the way he did and sanctioned people looking for to find out the truth behind this whole thing. At the end of the whole story, after the Secret Service agents testify, Ken Starr calls up Merletti in his office in Washington and says, you know, this was a complete waste of our time. You guys knew nothing. And Merletti was, you know, incensed, saying, we can't be drawn into a political battle. It wasn't about protecting Clinton. It was about protecting the mission of the Secret Service. That was the point that they were trying to make all the time.
Wow. I wanted to talk about the Secret Service and their mission and you know, their commitment to being non-political. I want to get to that. But the book, I'm assuming you didn't start writing the book like last month or last year. it probably took a while. And the question I'm leading to here is, did you ever get a chance to talk to Starr? Because he just died like a year and a half ago, right? Or something like that.
Yeah, well, I had contacted Ken Starr four times. And in the beginning, actually, his assistant gave me his, I called the office. He was at, I forgot the name of the university in Waco, Texas. And she gave me his personal email. And I contacted him four times. And I was turned down four times. It just wasn't going to happen. I thought, at one moment, I was going to fly to Texas and, you know, run him down at the university there and confront him. But I thought, you know, he could still say no and I'd have nothing. So, right. No, I tried numerous times to reach him. It was unfortunate that I couldn't. And his staff kept telling me, you know, you have to go through this process. And I kept calling back. And it just never happened. It would have been very interesting. But I spent 12 years researching this thing. A lot of that time was spent in the National Archives going through the independent counsel files. So what is in the book, Matt, is all based on information that comes directly from Ken Starr's independent counsel files.
Wow. What about Moletti? Did you? I don't even know if he's still alive. Is he still alive? And
oh, yeah. He retired and... Yeah, he's retired now, but at the time when I did this interview with Merletti, this was going to be for a potential documentary about this whole issue, about the, you know, asking about his conflict with Ken Starr and getting agents to testify.
Right.
And then he went into this whole other story, and this was a three-hour interview, and it was a good thing that I recorded it all because I could never take enough notes to remember all the details of this. But Merletti shared some of his documents from the time he was Secret Service agent, including an edited PowerPoint presentation that he gave Ken Starr and the Department of Justice, emphasizing the important role proximity is to presidents and other protectees. And that when you push protection away, what happens? And here's an interesting fact that maybe a lot of people don't know. One of the examples he gave was that 4 days before President Kennedy was in the motorcade in Dallas and was assassinated, 4 days before that, he was, I think, in Tampa, Florida, and the agents were riding on the sides of the limo, and Kennedy felt that the agents were creating a barrier and himself, and this was during a campaign appearance, so he ordered agents off the car. He said, I don't want to see these guys on the car anymore. They're creating this barrier. I'm out campaigning. So 4 days before his assassination, he orders agents off the car, and obviously he pushed them away, and this led to an assassination.
Well, that's a whole other book for you to write, but that just saying that, I mean, that adds to the idea that Kennedy had a death wish, because he knew there were death threats against him. He knew they were he canceled the thing in Chicago a week prior to Dallas. So it seemed like he might have just wanted to get assassinated or something when you say that. And but that actually was going to be the next question I was going to have for you was, so the president has the ability to say to the Secret Service, you get away from me. You can't. You know, I don't need your protection in this moment. I mean, or just say this is where you can go and this is where you can't go. They have that.
Well, this is one of the aspects that happens in the Secret Service. Whenever there's an incident like that, okay, they change procedures. Since that time, the president cannot tell agents what they can or cannot do for the purposes of protection. So that aspect was changed after the Kennedy assassination.
So that would kind of negate Moretti's argument there that trust and confidence, because that would suggest that the Secret Service can override the president's order to or say, I need privacy in this moment. And no, you can't. Well, my job is to protect you. That's where it gets really tricky, right?
Well, you know, if he's in the White House, obviously, and he's in the Oval Office, there's enough protection. There's enough protection around, so they don't have to actually be in the room. But you know, they're constantly around, and they are on alert for anything that may happen. But the idea is that if the president wants to go, he's very well scheduled, as you can imagine.
Right.
And everything is checked out by the Secret Service in advance. You know, if the president decides he's going to a show, a Broadway show or performance in Washington, D.C., and he says, I'd like to get up after the show and go backstage and thank the performers and everything, the head agent in charge would try to talk him out of this. And if he was really insistent on it, he said, we're going to need some time to secure the area back there. So it's the lead agent on the protective detail for the president has a tremendous amount of responsibility. So that's how that works.
Okay. Are you familiar with David Greenberg?
I'm writer, not, no.
Writer for Politico. I don't know what else he writes for. He has got a bit. Now, this is from 2022, right after Ken Starr's death, and he was writing about Ken Starr. His take on it was that Starr was a motivated player and basically created the Lewinsky affair and was using that Moretti statement or to kind of try to get Lewinsky to flip and become a president, a witness against the president. Any thoughts on that or comment on that?
Well, what they were interested in getting, they wanted either Moretti to confess to this deal or for Monica Lewinsky to flip. And that's why she was confronted in the Ritz-Carlton Hotel. So right. They wanted those things. So in Starr's handwritten notes, they wanted this so bad, I found a note that he recorded from, he would have these conferences in which all of the attorneys would be present in this big conference, and he would get feedback from everybody there in order before he would make a decision on something. So he was making many decisions by committee. And there was a note that I found that one of the associates said, you know, this would be a live grenade. We need Monica Lewinsky or the Secret Service or both. And Ken Starr agreed. But if you read his notes, I read 311 pages of his notes during the time frame of the Secret Service matter. He was, number one, he was obsessed with asking questions of his staff, not making definitive statements about what needs to be covered in terms of the investigation. And he was also very obsessed with public relations and what the press was writing about him constantly. He would constantly put notes down about, why is this guy against my, why is he standing up and talking about what I'm not doing correctly? And who is this reporter? And why is he saying these things about him? He was a very well-respected judge, and he had never been thrown into a situation like this before, as you can imagine. And he was besieged with questions from the press constantly. And it was a difficult issue for him. But as Special Counsel Joanne Harris told me several times during interviews was regarding Starr's process in coming to a decision that the captain of the ship does not consult with the crew on how to run the ship.
Right.
So he was constantly asking for feedback from everybody on this. And ultimately, you know, he would go along with whatever the staff, pretty much with what the staff wanted to do at that time.
Interesting.
And they really believed, even though they had no corroboration, they believed the source, and the source refused to come forward, refused to testify, but they still believe this. And as a matter of fact, to this day, a couple of the prosecutors, the former prosecutors I spoke with, still believe that Moretti had this deal with Clinton to keep quiet about Lewinsky, and I'll make you the next director. And as I show in the book, using documents from Starr's own office, that this never happened. It never took place. Now, what's interesting too in this, Matt, is I think you remember that Ken Starr came out with his own memoir. I think it was in 2020. He never mentions any of this. None of this is mentioned. And by the way, I forgot to add one other point to this. The name of Starr's secret source was named, self-identified as Deep Throat.
Yeah, right. But yeah. Self-identified.
See, yes.
There was a letter that I
located in the Independent Counsel files that he sent to Ken Starr explaining how to find Secret Service records that would show the comings and goings of the president.
That's what kind of strikes me as like a Zodiac letter 20 years after the Zodiac disappeared. I mean, because we all knew about Deep Throat from the Nixon era, and this guy was just like, that seems like a crazy person now. I'm going to call myself Deep Throat and inject myself into this political scandal and take a name from the past. That's kooky behavior to begin with, and that makes this source kind of suspect to me. If you're going to call yourself Deep Throat, like, can't you pick a better
well, let me say that I looked through the files after I came across this letter, and I had pulled up all of the emails that Independent Counsel office had received in terms of tips, and there were several mentions of Deep Throat, but they were really crazy theories. This particular letter was specifically addressed to Ken Starr and talked about Secret Service protocols. And so this was somebody who really had an idea of what was happening.
Did you or does anybody ever really pinpoint who we're talking about? Was he really even in the Secret Service? I mean,
yes, he was in the Secret Service, according to a source from someone I learned, secondhand source, that he was in the Secret Service. And I did have someone along the line that confirmed that, but never determined who it was. And they more or less disappeared into retirement on their own. And who knows who he is?
Right. Well, a lot of things went into this. I really want to get into the Secret Service and their mindset, because they are human. But there are so many questions that I have to ask you. First of all, the atmosphere of the time. Clinton was a dog. We know that he was a dog. He was a dog going back to high school days. You know, he was accused of rape in high school somehow as a star athlete and academic person. He got off on that. And then there was Paula Jones and Jennifer Flowers and all those people that came forth. We knew he was a dog.
Right.
Then they wanted, and Hillary came up with the vast right-wing conspiracy when Fisk, as you mentioned, kind of exonerated them on Whitewater, which is still puzzling to me, because I think there was something fishy there. Susan McDougal didn't go to jail for nothing, right? But it became a frustration.
Let me just interrupt you for a moment, Matt. But Susan McDougal went to jail not because of any specific crime. She went to jail because she was held in contempt of the prosecutor. Well, she would not testify about anything.
Yeah, she didn't want to talk about it. But that's just when you go to jail because you don't want to talk about it, it indicates that you know something was
right.
I mean, nobody willingly goes to jail for not testifying if they're going to tell the truth and it's going to exonerate everybody.
Right. Right. Yeah. Well, the thing is that if you remember, they were investigating the Whitewater land deal that the Clintons were involved in. They were looking into Travelgate. They were looking into Hillary Clinton's billing statements. They were also looking into the death of the deputy counsel, Vince Foster.
Right.
None of this was ever proven to be true. Or it was such a minor aspect that they were ready actually to close up the office. They were already starting to wind down their investigation when they got this late night tip from Linda Tripp about Monica Lewinsky. If they didn't get that, the whole investigation would have gone away.
Wow.
Now let me say, do I believe Clinton lied to the Independent Counsel? Sure, I do. But I think that the independent counsel office, the prosecutors, and Starr really stepped over the line on this. And poll after poll talked about this, especially when he involved Secret Service agents.
Right.
And people, there was a poll at the time that was done asking, do you believe that Secret Service agents should testify? And I think it was 48% of the people said no, it compromises security.
Right. I get it. The point I was awkwardly trying to make here is that when Fisk failed to nail Clinton to the cross or whatever, or put him in jail or get him in peace, well, whatever they were really trying to do, the Republican Party was out for blood. They were pissed off that this didn't work out. And that led to a circumstance where I think Starr probably had a lot of pressure on him to just get this guy for anything. Or did that not play into it at all?
Well, actually, Ken Starr stepped down from his role as independent counsel before this was finished. And the next independent counsel was Robert Ray. So he's the one that finished the investigation. He was given, Ken Starr was given a job offer, and he went back to private practice for the time. My guess is that he was just tired of the whole, all of this stuff that was constantly in the news. But he passed the ball on to Robert Ray, who was a deputy independent counsel at the time. He took over and finished the case. And even after Ken Starr made the phone call and said, you guys knew nothing, after Merletti had retired and was working for the Cleveland Browns, they called him back to Washington just before Clinton was ready to leave office. And they sat him down in a room in his lawyer's office and said, with two associate independent counsels and an FBI agent, you will tell us, you will confess to this deal. And he just couldn't believe that they were giving the same narrative all over again that Ken Starr said hadn't happened, and they had no proof on it, and they were still pressuring him on this at this time.
Interesting. Now, let's get to the Secret Service. Because my belief is that we are all human beings, and I understand that Secret Service have to be vetted very carefully to their ability to kind of be non-political, but so are Supreme Court justices, and it's this whole thing that's impossible for them to not have some kind of political affiliations. Secret Service, among all, is required to put any political ideas or ideology out of their job role, but that's a hard thing to do. We're seeing that today a little bit in the Trump stuff that, Secret Service, it seems, were willing to lie for him or not testify or try to avoid testifying, all this kind of stuff. Did you learn anything about the human factor of the Secret Service agents who were required to do this and their overall success of being able to separate themselves from their political ideologies?
Well, actually, there were a lot of reports. Well, it comes back to the leadership. And Merletti at that time was the Secret Service director, and he was a great leader. And at the time, just a few months before this all, anybody even knew the name of Monica Lewinsky, a book came out by Seymour Hersh, an investigative reporter, talking about, it was called The Dark Side of Camelot. And they had several former Kennedy agents come forward and talk about Kennedy's liaisons with all these women in the White House. And Merletti at that time sent out a teletype message to everyone stating, we don't reveal personal confidences like this, even after a president has left office. And there were several agents that I, in terms of news reports and books and everything, where they would step forward and say, we're non-political. Whatever our personal beliefs are in terms of politics, we're focused on one thing, the mission of protection. And we have to have proximity to be able to do our mission successfully. And that's what they were focused on. Obviously, things changed during the Trump administration and they compromised the mission, according to the available evidence that I've read about in newspaper accounts.
Yeah.
But at this time, Merletti stood four square behind this, and actually, before he made his case to Ken Starr about compelling agent testimony, he met with all former Secret Service directors to get their feedback on this, and they said, absolutely, you've got to fight this thing. Trust and confidence, that's the tenet, that's the mission of the Secret Service. You're the first one to be tested, don't let us down. So wow. He didn't make this decision in a vacuum. He was very focused on the mission, and as were the previous. It all comes down to leadership.
It does. But, human nature, even though as hard as I try to kind of separate myself and try to be completely non-biased and independent, I can't imagine that humanly it's possible. Now, is it because this is a tricky thing here. When you talk about criminal activity, how is the Secret Service? I know most of these guys went to law school or took law courses in their criminal. What is the degree you get? Criminal justice courses.
Right.
They know about this stuff, but an intern, a 22-year-old who is legal, and a president, there is some. Versus, criminal, real hardcore criminal activity. There's this line that the Secret Service, because you talk about it, they don't get involved in personal stuff, but criminal activity, they are bound to kind of witness it. And how do they draw that line or discern where that line is?
Well, clearly there was no criminal activity between Lewinsky and Clinton. That was certainly a private matter. No criminality at all in that.
If I can, I agree with you, but I could see the people who think that there were in that this compromises the president, and he swore an oath not to to protect the Constitution against all enemies, foreign and domestic, and this definitely puts him against his oath because it creates a situation where he's compromised and he can be blackmailed and all that kind of stuff. So that's the argument that people make, that it could be criminal. It could rise to the level of criminal.
Actually, that wasn't the issue. The issue was that Lewinsky had lied on her affidavit about being involved with the president. And that fact was going to be used on another case that Clinton had, where he had this affair with somebody. They wanted to catch Clinton and they wanted to catch Lewinsky. And that's why they confronted her at the Ritz-Carlton Hotel to prove that she was, confront her that she was lying on this affidavit. That was the crime. Wow. There was no crime per se for the affair itself. The crime was lying to a federal prosecutor. And the way the rules are, if you are interviewed by the FBI or any federal investigator and you lie in your testimony, you can go to jail.
Right.
So that's what this was all about.
That's a perjury, whether it's in court or not. You can't lie.
They wanted to lie. They wanted to catch Clinton in a lie. This was the best way that they could do this after all the other cases fell along the wayside. And getting Secret Service testimony would be another aspect as to how to catch Clinton on this. Now, there's another interesting story that Merletti told me in this regard. If you remember, there was a blue dress that Lewinsky had that had semen stains on it. And so part of her immunity agreement required that she turn this blue dress in, and it underwent forensic testing. And we all found out later that there was semen on there because they did a blood test of Clinton, which is really crazy in and of itself. But what happened before that information came out is Director Merletti was at a conference for fallen. It was a fundraiser for fallen security people and law enforcement officers. And he's approached by an FBI agent who was working with Ken Starr, and he was in charge of the lab that was testing this dress. So he approaches Merletti at this conference, and he says, I really need to have a conversation with you. And he says, well, fine, sit down here and let's talk about it. And he says, no, this has to be in private. So they go to a private spot where people aren't bothering them. And he sits down and he says, listen, I know it's been a tough time for you at the Secret Service. I want you to know that I'm in charge of testing that dress. And you know what? We found nothing. There's no DNA connected to Clinton on this dress. Wow. They did this because they wanted to catch, to see if Merletti would then share this information with Clinton before his testimony. He was going to give grand jury testimony,
setting him up,
where he was going to be in the White House. They were going to use this to try to catch Clinton. And of course, it was all false. Merletti did not have any personal relationship with Clinton outside of his job of protection.
Sounds like Merletti's a stand-up righteous guy.
Absolutely. And you can imagine the pressure that he was put under in terms of the way Washington worked that way. And it's even more so today.
Right.
That's the basic reason why I did this story, and I wrote this book, is because I thought this was an incredible story of integrity. And Merletti shows in the book how he demonstrated the character and courage to stand up and tell the truth.
Very cool.
Repeatedly.
Did you ever get a chance to, or did it matter to you at all? Did you want to talk to Monica Lewinsky, and did you get a chance to?
I communicated by email with her a few times, but that really wasn't, I wasn't interested in that whole part. The real focus of the story for me was on Merletti's personal battle behind the scenes and his public battle in which he was trying to prevent agents from being questioned by Starr prosecutors, because that was the trust and confidence tenet. He did not want that violated. Ultimately, as everyone knows, they did have to testify, and there was nothing there. Nobody knew anything. They knew Lewinsky because she was in the White House and was coming and going in her regular job there as an intern, but nobody had any direct evidence that showed that that Merletti was involved in something like this. And the immunity agreement that Monica Lewinsky signed before she gave her grand jury testimony required that she reveal everything there was to know, answer all the questions honestly, and even answer questions by omission. In other words, she had to volunteer if there was any other information that she had that the independent counsel didn't know of. She never revealed stuff because there was nothing there.
I would love to have a chat with her. I understand she wasn't vital to the mission of your book, but she's just a fascinating historical figure at this point. Now, I was thinking about this last night. You're writing history books, and the time generally history books are written till 100 years after history happens. You're writing within 25 years. Most of my audience is within 35 to 50 range. They were children when this was happening,
and exactly.
And yeah, so it's an important story for them to learn. First of all, is the book out? Because
the book is scheduled for release on the 28th of this month. And this month, of course, is the 25th anniversary of the Starr investigation. But I will tell your listeners this. This really fills a big gap in our understanding of the Ken Starr investigation, something that has never been reported before. The book is very straightforward. It's very easy to read. It's not, you know, tremendously dense like a lot of history books are. It's really somewhat of a detective story as to how all of this happened and why it happened. And they were so focused on getting Clinton that this was the best way they thought to be able to do that. As I mentioned earlier, they were, according to Joanne Harris, the special counsel, were already winding up the office duties when this tip came in from Linda Tripp.
Right.
That's when everything turned.
Linda Tripp is another, I don't know how history will remember her, but she's another fascinating story to me. I would love to talk to her. I don't even know if she's still alive, but
no, she passed away.
I could go talk to her, but she won't talk back. Now, advanced copy. Can people pre-order now, by the way, trust and confidence?
I don't think so. I think the pre-order process could probably start maybe late next week. According to the publishing firm that I'm working with, is they upload the files. It's going to be an ebook as well as a hardcover book. And of course, a lot of people use the e-reader now, which is much easier to access.
Right. Or an audiobook. People love audiobooks.
Well, unfortunately, there's no audiobook yet.
Yeah.
So that hasn't happened.
I think the publisher will probably push for that. Yeah, but last bit here. Now, because that leads, I'm assuming now you haven't sent out advanced copies to like Secret Service people or people who were involved to get their comment or feedback on it.
No, I haven't. I mean, I sent a copy to Lou Merletti and everything because I maintain contact with him. But he's of a mindset that, you know, he's tired of the story. He wants to move on. He's in retirement. This happened 25 years ago. I don't want to talk about it anymore.
I think the public, that's what I was asking, like, why not? Because I think our attention span, whatever, and we have a political scandal every half hour on the hour now that people might be inclined to say, I can't go down to 125 years ago. I wish you luck with it. And I am obviously intrigued by the story. I wouldn't have you here. But I just feel like the American public is kind of worn out on political scandal stuff.
And I thought so too until I came across this story that I thought was, no one had ever heard this story before.
Yeah.
So I hope your listeners will be interested enough to get the book. My take on it so far is that from what I've learned from the publishing company is that it will come out no later than the 28th of this month.
Excellent. Well, good luck with it. And thanks for being here. And thanks for writing a book. I mean, you taught me some things here today. Are you prepared for, I don't know, people, you know how social media is today. You're either people love you or they hate you. And people like trying to jump to conclusions about your bias here and what you're trying to prove and any of that.
That's a very good question. And I wanted to come to this whole issue as an honest broker as well. When I first heard Merletti's story, he was very forceful in how this happened, and he explained all the details of this, telling me this story as if it had happened yesterday. I mean, there was no pause. But then I had to go and try to research this stuff myself. I contacted the independent special counsel Joanne Harris, who investigated the confrontation of Lewinsky at the Ritz-Carlton, which ultimately led me into the National Archives. And like I said, most of the documents I use in this book and the conclusions I draw from it is they're documents directly from Ken Starr's files. Wow. So it's all there.
Well,
these documents have never been released before. The documents I cite and use in the book have never been previously released. And let me tell you something, searching the independent count, searching anything in the archives takes a long time.
I bet it does. This is why people are reluctant to, when they say do your own research, they mean go to YouTube. Nobody really wants to go into Freedom of Information files or any of that kind of stuff and actually really do their own research. They'd rather a talking head like me, who really is uneducated in this stuff, just give my opinion.
Right.
And that's enough.
Right. Can I mention just a couple things?
Sure.
The website address that you're giving below, giving reader or viewers at the bottom of the screen here, that's the website that talks about the book. And when the release date is confirmed, that will be on the website. But I also have another website that I've had for a number of years called itsethicsstupid.com.
It's ethicsstupid.com.
And readers can go there and look up the commentaries I write twice a week, and they'll find out about announcements about the book as well.
Oh, I hope you'll come back after I get a chance to review that site, because, you know, I feel like ethics is surely lacking in our political discourse and political, elected officials and all that kind of stuff. So I would love to at some point have you back to talk about some of the articles.
I'd like to do that again. I really would.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming. Have a great day. And I hope you do well with the book, but I will definitely reach out after I read that. It's ethicsstupid.com and all the stuff that you have there, because that's a really interesting subject. So thank you for coming. Have a great day and good luck.
Thanks, Matt.
Bye for now. Jim Lichtman, folks. Interesting stuff there. Did you learn anything? I learned stuff. Willie is here. He'll be here with the news in just one moment. I need to take a really short break, and I will be right back. The link, by the way, to trustandconfidence.com is in the description. Wherever we're allowed to put that description, that means Facebook, YouTube, all those places. On the radio, it's just trustandconfidence, all one word, .com. And it's it's ethics stupid. I will get the link to that and put that in the description as well. It's an interesting URL. Anyway, I will just take a very short break. I promise you this is going to be a short one. I will be right back if I could just find my right buttons to push here. There you go.
Hey, yeah, mind dog, yeah, mind dog. If you're ready for some action, this dog sure to keep you laughing. Let's go. Mind dog, yeah, yeah, mind dog. Don't roll, don't play fetch, only here to keep your interest. This is the show that you've been missing, full of comedians and musicians. Plenty of interviews, entertaining, keep it funny, there ain't no debating. Call the man, you never know what they gon' say. Bean Flicker Kelly and Whiskey Dick Willie Conway. So authentic and straight raw, pushing the limits when they talk, doing it live when they stream. Mind dog TV, yeah, so crazy, getting intense. The dogs are wild, better beware before you hop over the fence. Mind dog, yeah, yeah, mind dog. If you're ready for some action, this dog sure to keep you laughing. Let's go. Mind dog, hey, mind dog. Don't roll, don't play fetch, only here to keep your interest. Let's go.
I'm back already.
Come have coffee with the dog.
Okay, Lou, kill that. Thank you. Oh, good morning, Willie. I don't talk about the escaped convict, Daniello Cavalcanti. We'll talk about that later. Let's stay on this Jim Lichtman book for just a second. Did you learn anything in that 40-minute interview?
I mean, bro, I took a couple breaks, honestly.
Oh.
It doesn't interest me, bro. I don't give two craps about Clinton and Lewinsky anymore. I really, to be honest,
it's not really about Clinton and Lewinsky, though. See, that's
right. It's that, no, the little bit that I did catch, it sounds like it's more about like the Secret Service and this
and their ability to, stay within the trust range of the president and not not be forced to give out personal information and all that stuff. And for me, from a human perspective, could you do that? Could if your duty is to guard the president, but can you do that and completely like have blinders on when he's fucking a 22-year-old?
I mean, I'm a pretty compartmentalized person, so I think, but I do think it takes a certain temperament or whatever, you know what I mean? Because if you have a hard time putting stuff in boxes, you know what I mean? Then yeah, it could be difficult for you, you know what I mean? Because those things blur so easily or whatever, you know?
Unfortunately, you are right in the demographic of this listenership, and I think you were a kid when this.
A teenager,
right? When this was going on. Oh,
yeah. So what? 92, 93?
The Lewinsky thing was 98, really.
Oh, 90. Yeah. So yeah, I was 17 in 98.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, I this is why I think a lot of people, first of all, will probably assume that this book, because on the cover, you got that picture of Bill facing Lewinsky, and that was kind of the evidence that he did know her, despite I don't even know this, you know, whatever he said. I don't know that woman, Miss Lewinsky. But obviously he did. But a lot of people are going to assume this book is about the affair, not about that sacred trust. And this just highlights to me the kind of special people that have to be in the Secret Service and how you find those people. Because it's more than just what you said, being able to put stuff in boxes and compartmentalize stuff. It's putting your life online, ready to take a bullet for somebody.
Oh, sure.
Even if you totally disagree with their politics. And I don't know
how
to do that.
Right.
Because it's going to change. The Secret Service remained there from Trump to Biden. Those are two very different political ideologies. You got to be willing to take a bullet for either. That's a tough. And where do you find these people who can keep a secret, keep things personal in the closet, and still be willing to just take a bullet and guard with your life.
I mean, those are people committed to the job. You know what I mean? Like in my mind, people like that, like the job ranks supreme, and like the duties that are involved with this position, you know, I take so seriously that I'm not going to waver from that. Like, my opinion about it doesn't matter. And I mean, I would, you know, in politicians, you know, even clergy members, you know, religious leaders, I wish that they would get a lot of their personal feelings out of the way. You know, even when I was of a Christian faith, I was very adamant about letting people know that, like, I was not like anti-gay. I was not like I was not like a hateful person during my Christian days. You know what I mean? Because I didn't believe that that's what Christians were called to do. You know what I mean? Yeah. And so, you know, people have a right and wrong perspective in whatever they do a lot of times. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I never thought about the president being protected by people adverse to him, because like when you think about it, you would think that you'd be able to prick your own detail, what I mean, or at least say you didn't want certain people.
Well, that could be dangerous too, because listen, it's like, I don't want to get overly political here today, because people know where I stand on Donald Trump, but that is, you know, a mob boss being able to pick his own security staff can lead to people who are willing to cover up crimes, which goes beyond personal behavior. Now, this was, again, I agree with Jim Lichtman on this fact that there was no crime committed in the affair, but people have made arguments forever since it happened that just the compromising himself in a way where he could be blackmailed would be a crime by the president no matter what, because it puts his oath to the Constitution in jeopardy. So, but to be able to pick your own guys, listen, then you're able to pick guys who would cover up a crime for you,
right? Yeah, no, that's definitely a fair point for sure.
Yeah,
I remember back in the day, I was a real scandalous dude, the fact that I had like four or five homies that would vouch for anything I said was like gold, bro.
Yeah. So I'm gonna get the book. After I read the book, I'll send it to you. Will you read it?
I mean, yeah, I'll give it a read. I'm not against reading it.
Yeah.
Especially because it sounds like it's about. He is right. It is an aspect of the story that people really don't know about. It is a new side of an old story.
To people your age, now I was very politically active as a teenager, so I was well aware of everything that was going on with Watergate when I was a teenager, young teen. But people your age, this was just something that they saw. It was
it was noise. It was background noise.
It was in between whatever the thing on MTV was about the house.
It was in between us doing the Macarena and you know what I mean, dude. The 90s were insane. Listen, if we ever we've never really talked about my 90s, bro. It's insane.
But for people your age, the 90s stuff was happening, but they weren't necessarily caring about any of this stuff. And it really was a story about a blowjob, and hard for people to understand, like, why is that against the law?
What the fuck is the problem? I'm trying to get one too. What the fuck? You know what I mean? Like,
the weird thing, and I don't know if she would ever talk about this, but saving the dress and not having it dry cleaned. Like, this is a friggin' memento. This is a trophy from when you banged the president. I don't know. It's because it is incriminating evidence. Like, you'd have
sure.
It's so bizarre that she didn't have to clean. It feels skeezy to even talk about the dress.
Oh my God. You know what? I'm going to give you a confession about myself, Matt. Okay. And my wife can totally verify this because I was bad back in the day and I was a hoe. I was super bad. And, like it was not uncommon for me to have like 3 to 5 sets of panties on my gear shifter car. I would just collect panties on my gear shifter. I'm not even kidding, bro. Hold on. Sorry.
I hate that we even went here. Did those panties contain any criminal possible evidentiary thing that could be used against you in a court of law or get you to flip on somebody, you know, be able to blackmail you to flip on somebody and give testimony against somebody?
I mean, probably not, because they always came off pretty fast.
Makes it totally different. She had Linda Tripp. I think Linda Tripp. Maybe I should call Tim Lichtman back up. This idea that Linda Tripp, she was the one who tipped him off that the blue dress even existed. Like, so Monica had to confide in her somehow. Now we talk about integrity of Mulledy. Linda Tripp seems like a person you don't want to tell your secrets.
Yeah, that's the total opposite. the exact opposite of this guy. Yeah. Now,
I think she was probably one of these people, because this is where it comes down to with the Secret Service. Because I did a lot, even after I was out of government service in the 80s. In the 90s and 2000s, I worked for companies that marketed to government employees and spent a lot of time talking to government employees in that role, and they all do have their own political biases, and I think Linda Tripp probably had a strong Republican bias. She was part of these people who just wanted to get Clinton on anything, and even though she was still working, I don't know that for a fact, but I mean, what would be her motivation to come forth and talk about address to people who, you know, and she would be inserting herself into pub headlines and all that kind of stuff. I don't think you would do that without political bias. And I just know that government agencies, all of them, are filled with people who have strong opinions about politics. And that's a danger of having that, because it's like running an organization where you don't know. It is not like it. It is exactly it. Running an organization where you don't know if the people who are working for you are enemies of the organization or not, or enemies of the leader of the organization or not. It's a tricky thing. Right. And this is where you have to kind of separate yourself and be able to do that. I don't know the Secret Service. I don't know that they're really 100% able to do that even today. And obviously with the Trump stuff, they were definitely loyal to Trump. The Secret Service became extremely loyal to Trump. Anyway, we'll come back. We'll do the news, but I have to do the Laurie S. Strikingly Hilarious is a frequent contributor. She's been doing pieces called Weirdiful Wednesdays. It's a very short piece. Let's see if we can get to this right now. And probably going to take up probably about a minute and a half. So bear with me while we play this part.
Did you get the photo I sent you on Messenger?
No, I didn't. Hi,
this is Lori S. Strikingly Hilarious with another episode of Weirdiful Wednesdays. So I'm car shopping. I have been perusing the Consumer Reports new and used car list. I think it used to be in one book, but not anymore. So my car is 16 years old. It's in good condition, but I'm just ready to get something with some safety features on it. I also would like something that I could go car camping in, but that's a story for another day. So I've been looking at the names of cars. And so the Ford has a car called the Escape, and they even have a trim line called the Escape Active. Really, do we want our cars running away from us? Nissan has a car called the Rogue. If there's one thing I don't want my car to do, it's for my car to go rogue. The Mitsubishi has a Mirage. I've never seen one, though. Did you know that the Hyundai Elantra, the word Elantra in Spanish means a female woman of the night? I wonder what they call it in Spain. The Kia has a carnival. That just makes me think of like springs and noises and just chaos in the car. So the Subaru has an Ascent Limited as well as an Outback Limited. I wonder if the car tells you if you've ascended too high or if you've gone too far in the Outback. And my last car story. So one day I was going to my friend's house and I was behind a Subaru and the vanity license plate said itchy, I-T-C-H-Y. And I said, why? I said, wow, too. Why? That car is quite a legacy. But don't you think that might have been a better vanity plate for a Forester? That's all for now. Bye.
Oh, yeah. Well, Laurie S. Strikingly Hilarious. She's got a show coming up on the 28th. She's going to, I don't have the details for it yet, but she's in Arizona. Anyway, we appreciate Laurie's efforts here every day. We should do the news now. Craig is in the back there. We're going to bring him in pretty quickly, but we should do the news now, which means don't say a word. I have to introduce you with my big news. I this is important to me that I play this dopey little clip before Willie does the news. So let's do that. And now, here with the news is Willie Cronkite. You're on, dude.
Oh, I thought you were going to do the thing.
What thing? I did the thing. Go ahead.
The world thing?
Yeah, we did the world thing.
I missed it. How did I miss it?
I don't know.
Where was I?
I don't know.
All right. Well,
our news guy who can't see the news right in front of his face.
I didn't see the world going around. You know what I mean? You know what I learned yesterday, though? I learned that once many years ago, Chuck Norris struck the world.
Oh.
And it's still spinning.
Wow.
That's how tough Chuck Norris is. I'm sorry. All right. Anyway, here's the news. Developments in the search for Danilo Cavalcante at 10:10 on Monday evening, a homeowner called state police stating that Cavalcante had entered his garage and was in possession of a scope 22 rifle that he took from the garage. The homeowner took shots at the escapee and it's believed that Cavalcante was unharmed. While it does appear that he is headed north, the search for the area, the search area continues to only cover about 8 to 10 square miles. The U.S. Marshals Service is now involved. Kansas City quarterback Patrick Mahomes had a recent realization that punctuation matters. On Monday during the Jets versus Bills game, the quarterback tweeted, "Hate that man," after quarterback Aaron Rodgers was injured. He quickly edited his call for the unified hatred towards the injured QB to one of "hate that man," or to put it like a 90s Valley Girl would, "getting injured is such a bummer."
Like so much.
Yeah. Anyway, yesterday marked 20 years since the passing of country legend Johnny Cash, and Trent Reznor of Nine Inch Nails opened up to Music Radar about his feelings on the man's Man in Black's cover of his song Hurt. He said, "It's like watching someone else kiss your girlfriend," the singer said. To that, I say, what an odd feeling to get familiar with. You know what I mean?
Like, yeah.
Quentin Tarantino is finishing up work.
I'm sorry. I'm not a Quentin fan. So when you said he was finishing up, I got excited. I thought he was done. Like,
Well, no, okay, so he's starting work on his 10th and final theatrical film. The filmmaker has long said that he only wishes to do 10 major releases to preserve his legacy. So he will be filming in California starting this fall, which is where everything began back in 1993 with Reservoir Dogs, which I saw 90 seconds of when it came out on VHS, and my mother's face turned into the shock emoji. She got up, hit stop, and said, well, that's enough of that.
That is enough. I like you, Ron.
One more story. This one, I had to throw this in here. This, I literally got this right before the show. Rapper 50 Cent, and I don't know if you found that picture or not, but rapper 50 Cent could be facing criminal battery charges. 50 was doing a show in L.A. at the Crypto.com Arena when he had problems with multiple microphones, and one microphone that he chucked like a baseball struck Power 106 host Brianna Moynihan in the forehead. The DJ claims that Jackson aimed and struck her on purpose. Personally, I think 50 mushroom stamped her at the studio before the show.
Oh my God, that was brutal.
No, that's a shit. Yeah, like, I mean, obviously that didn't happen, but that picture, I saw that picture, I was like, oh my God, that's right. But microphones are unforgiving. Like, I've donked myself in the head a time or two, like, for a joke, and I learned very quickly to, like, just use my hand. Like, even if I throw my other hand up there so I make it look like I hit my hand, I'll still hit my hand because right. That's smarts. Right. Microphones to the dome do not feel good.
Well, let's give a little props to David Lee Roth, who did basically that to himself. And when he went backstage for a minute, they rubbed some dirt in it, and he went back out and continued the performance. Our next guest is here. I don't know if you've ever met Craig. Craig Mitchell is, as I say, he calls himself a former comedian or ex-comedian. I don't think it's like the, you know, military service. Once you're in, you're that for life. Whether you're doing stand-up or not, you're still a comedian for life. So I think he's a comedian for life. He's a host of Off the Cuff Cooking, which I think has its 6th series premiering this week, maybe tonight. I'm not sure. He's also a co-host of the Big Bad Broadcast. He's here now. He's been on the program many times before, and it's early morning for him. Good morning, Craig.
I'm so tired.
Hey, what's with your volume, dude? Can you turn your volume up a little?
How about that? Any better?
Oh, that's better.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, good. I am so tired is what I said.
You are. Just
fatigué in French.
Well, good morning.
Good morning. I got to tell you about the microphone thing. You're absolutely right. I used to do a thing in my act where I would bang myself. Like, I'm an idiot. Boom,
and banging yourself, what does that have to do with microphone? Oh, you mean with the microphone.
I do that at home. I do that at home, too. No, but I hit the microphone on my head, and I'm just talking. The whole crowd got quiet, and blood started trickling down.
Right. Yeah.
So I've done that. I'm an idiot.
Wow. Hey,
I mean, that chick had a hole in her head.
You know what? I don't think 50 Cent did it on purpose, or 50 Cent did it on purpose.
I mean, how are you aiming in a crowd of people? Like, there's no way. You know what I mean? Like, he was I will say he was mad, and he did chuck it. It was the second or third microphone that went out on him, you know? And so he definitely chucked it, but to say that he aimed it and hit you on purpose is a little ridiculous.
That sounds like a challenge.
Matt, you might remember this. You remember when he threw the first pitch at the Met game? He threw the ball from it, like, went 8 feet towards the dugout. There's no way he could hit somebody on purpose.
Right. Thank you.
I'm playing at the Family Fest this Sunday in Tanner Park in Copenhagen, New York, and it sounds like a challenge I'll have to take up. I'll see if I can spot somebody in the audience I'd like to bop with my microphone, and I'll let you know, because I'm not really – I was never a great pitcher to begin with, but – We'll see if I can do it. If I can, you know, knock somebody out from the stage with a microphone and claim it was an accident. Oh, I don't know. I'm just being a rock star, man.
I'm just being a rock star. Oh my God. That's the best excuse, bro.
All right. Before we get to Craig and the premiere of the season premiere of Off the Cuff, in your news story there. First of all, it looked like the National Guard roughed up Cavalcante pretty good. I don't know if you saw the pictures where they got the guy, the escaped convict.
Yeah.
It looked like they gave him a better beating than 57 gave that.
I mean, probably. You know, he probably looked like that dude that tried to attack Dave Chappelle.
Right. 50 Cent. It's 50 Cent.
50 Cent.
Right.
The other thing, the Quentin stuff. Quentin Tarantino. I think history, 50 years, 100 years from now, they'll look back and say, what the fuck was it about Quentin Tarantino that people loved his movies? No. His movies suck.
Are you kidding? I love the dude. I'm a huge Tarantino fan.
His movies suck.
No. Man, are you kidding me? I could watch Inglourious Bastards again and again.
I know right now people love it.
I love it.
The stories are not compelling at all, or not even tied together well. He's a comic book writer with a film camera.
I like them. I think they're great movies.
You're not alone. Society loves them. I'm just saying, 100 years from now, people will look back and say, what the fuck?
No, I think they're going to do that to Adam Sandler.
I think people right now are looking back and saying, well, you know, Adam Sandler is tremendously talented.
He is.
But his movies definitely suck.
Well, that's actually why Bob Barker died, is he just couldn't stomach the new Sandler film coming out. He was like, I can't do it.
You know what? Wow. You would trade places with either Tarantino or Sandler.
Oh, of course. All day long. And if Adam Sandler wanted to put me in a movie all day long, please, sir. I mean, God, yes. Why would I ever say no? These are jokes, folks. We're just busting balls.
That's right. That's right.
I like to bust balls because I only got the one, you know?
The fact is, Sandler would never put you in one of his movies because you don't kiss his ass enough. That's.
I mean, I could start.
You
got to
be
a
Rob Schneider, dude. You got to be a Rob Schneider dude and kind of like totally suck up to him. All of those people who became devotees. All right, we can move on. Now that people know that I am anti Tarantino, I'm the anti Tarantino.
You seem like a Tarantino guy.
I am.
You do.
So
he's a priceless Ford Coppola guy. Is who
you bet your balls I am.
I know. Believe me, I know, bro.
I'm also
Martin Scorsese. That's his dude.
I think Eastwood.
Eastwood. Unforgiven. One of my favorite movies of all time.
Yeah, great movie.
Yeah,
great movie.
I don't think it's just Unforgiven. I think Clint changed the way movies are directed with. Because in the old days, and this is the old days, in my day, it was action, cut, all that kind of stuff. Clint is like, could you start?
Yeah, right.
And I think it definitely changes actors' mindsets when you come with that approach. Like, you know, and the way, because the guy yells action at you. You're literally like hypertense. No matter what you're supposed to be acting like, you got this, you know, somebody just yelled like, get out of the room.
Sure, sure.
So yeah,
but yeah, do your thing, do what you're here for. That he was very not like very casual like that. Yeah.
You say he was like he's dead. I don't know.
Well, I mean, well, he's not directing a lot, is what I'm saying.
I don't know. I think he might be working on a picture now.
Yeah, the last movie he did wasn't it Macho something?
I don't know.
Something like that. Yeah,
Gran Torino was another great movie.
I love
Gran Torino. Is a good one.
Yeah. So, Craig, off the cuff, it premieres this week?
Yeah, we have our sneak. We actually, the series itself on streaming network on Strong Island Entertainment, which you can download and watch on Roku or go to their YouTube channel. It's going to debut on October 1st. But we have a sneak peek on my webpage, which is www.offthecuffwithcraigmitchell.com. On Sunday, so if you go to the webpage, you'll be able to see the entire first episode of season 6 on the webpage as a sneak peek.
Ah, now who's on it? Who's the guest?
I don't have I do have a guest actually. His name is Darryl Phillip, and he's an actor, and he plays a private detective who calls me on my own shit.
Now, do you get a lot of? I mean, are there a lot of people who are like searching for low-carb recipes and things to cook, or is it just that people coming for entertainment alone? Is it, you know, are the people who really are interested in doing that? Because I listen, I'm not a low-carb guy. But even if I saw a recipe show, something looked good to me. Looks good, but I'm not gonna fucking go into the kitchen and cook it.
Well, I feel the same way. That's why I use simple recipes at work. I mean, because the last thing I want to do is spend 2 hours in the kitchen and eat for 5 minutes. That's not balanced. It's got to be close. It's got to be closer to like, you know, cook for 10, eat for 5. You know what I'm saying? I don't like to spend all day in the kitchen, but I love the results. So I try to make it as economical as possible. And as far as people who watch the show, I find that some people watch for the comedy and some people watch for the cooking. And I guess a few watch for both. But
how much of your life do you put into it? Because you do all the editing, the writing, the editing, the shooting, all of it. How much of your life, how much of a life commitment is this for you?
It takes about 4 full days to shoot it and about 3 days to write it.
Oh my
God. I do one every 2 weeks.
That you know, that's a lot of life commitment.
I know.
Yeah, plus you have the big broadcast stuff going on.
Yeah, that's
bad broadcast.
I just show up and I get teased. So
that's you're not doing the bookings for that, because you've had some incredible guests on.
It's you know what, it's the great thing about doing that is we do a pre-meeting, we discuss what we're going to do, and then we do the show with a guest or without a guest, and we do nothing what we planned. We just we don't do anything, you know. Like this week was an exception. We're coming up. We did do something. We wanted to do stuff on Woodstock because John Farentino has some amazing Woodstock stories, and we actually did stick to the plan this week, which is very rare. We have Jim Rabiola, Labriola's on this week as a guest, as a matter of fact. But we're pretty lucky, and you helped us connect us to Tommy Chong. He's been on 3 times.
Well, does Farentino know that I helped make that happen?
Hell yeah! I tell him every time he's on.
Does he not love me or something? Because he could get me Graham Nash, but he doesn't. He won't.
Did you ask him?
Of course, I've sent several emails. Like anything, you know.
What a cock he is!
I would move heaven and hell to get Graham Nash on his phone. Well, I don't know.
I'll bug him a little bit, but then again, you know, I don't have.
I'm counting on you. Get me Graham Nash.
Wow. Okay.
Sign the papers now. Get me Graham Nash. I'll tell you what. You get me Graham Nash, I'll get you William Conway on your show.
Oh, really?
Yes,
man,
dude.
Man. I figure it's
he is pouring you out, man. He's pouring.
Hey,
you out.
Listen, he knows a hoe when he sees one.
And by the way, just to let people know, if they want to watch my cooking show, it's G rated. It really, it's family friendly.
That's okay.
I don't talk like this on the show.
No, I hate that. I hate you. That it's G-rated. Yeah. I think I need to drop one F-bomb in a show.
I bleep it. I do. If you ever saw this sitcom, The Goldbergs, I do the Goldberg method. I curse, but I bleep it.
I would say that my sisters and my aunts would both contend. They would all four contend that I would probably be funnier if I wasn't so... like blue or whatever, because like I'm more silly. Like I ramp up the silliness when I'm being funny in not a gross way. I just get super silly, and they love that. You know what I mean?
You know what? I'm sorry. I think the profanity placing profanity is an art form. That's what I'm
it
talking.
Is.
It really is.
I push it. I push that. It all the time.
Fuck that. yeah, all right. Now, comedians that you've had on the cooking show, though, some prominent comedians on it. Now, are you planning? Do you have a schedule like of guests this week that you, this season that you have already lined up, or you wait until like the week before you start to shoot and call somebody up and say?
Well, you know, it's kind of tough for a couple of reasons. My producer, who was also used to run the camera for me, when I did guest spots, moved to Oregon. So now it's a one man show. I show up my tripod and my light, and people go, "What are you doing?" You know, what, I thought this was a professional production, but no. I like Bruce Baum, comedian Bruce Baum is going to be appearing this season.
Wasn't Bruce on previous seasons?
Oh yeah,
no?
Yeah, Bruce is one of my favorites, man. If you've never seen his stand up. He is
incredible. I don't think he's ever been on this show. How geez. That's kind of funny.
He'll come on your show for sure.
That's what I was waiting to hear.
I shouldn't talk to him, but I think he would.
Now, I was on your show.
Yeah.
Did that get like incredible rating? Did you get like several million people?
No, he's an immediate no.
I mean, the thing is, that was back when I was on YouTube and we should do it again because you were great.
I was great. You're right. I was fabulous.
Matt is always great.
I probably should have been nominated for a Webby for that or something.
Is that a thing? That's a thing you can get. What? How can you get a Webby? You know what's this thing?
Here's the thing. You have to send them like $10,000 to get nominated.
Really?
It's one of those bullshit things. Like, and you can nominate yourself, but everything comes with a fee for a Webby award.
Everybody's got a price.
Boasting about their Webby awards, and I didn't want to kind of, podcasters who were kind of, you know, and there's a podcasters award thing that is a paper award kind of stuff too. But people are boasting about that, and I don't want to be a dick and say, "Listen, you paid for that. Anybody could buy themselves an award."
They say the same thing with the Oscars. It's who you schmooze while you get nominated, right?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. But you know what? I was just talking about this with my wife and my son last night because I was going through articles and stuff, and there was some article about how John Cena is going to go down as the greatest champion of all time. And I'm like, wait a second. I'm like, how do they determine who the greatest professional wrestler champion is when like that? It's like it's not even real.
I could give you the. I think I know. My answer would be dollar amount raised. Of
yeah, like what you bring in that sort of. Yeah, sure. Clarity, but like
merchandise.
Yeah.
Like, and I mean, I'm sure Cena's up there. I'm sure he's got to be in the top five for sure.
There with Stone Cold and Hulk for sure.
Oh yeah, I mean.
What about The Rock? Wasn't The Rock in?
Yeah, The Rock. I think.
We lost. He'll be right back. He does this every once in a while. Because he's a glutton for. He's just trying to get attention. He does that for attention every single time. Back. You do that for attention.
I'm so sorry. I don't.
wait! I want more attention.
No, you know what? You didn't get the spinning ball. You gotta get.
I don't like to do that in public. Okay.
Yeah, he doesn't like to spin his balls in public.
I like to do that in private.
He only does the Chinese thing on his scrotum in private. Yeah,
I find that comforting because Willie likes to talk about his ball all the time. I mean,
I do
nothing. Every conversation comes back to his ball.
So it's singular. It's a singular ball.
It is singular. Yes. Thank you for being numerically correct. Yes. I only have one testicle. So that's correct. I mean,
is that because it merged or because?
No, he got it shot off in a gunfight.
I
did
get it shot off. It was a terrible, terrible situation.
You got it shot off?
In a gunfight. A gunfight. You hear me? Yeah. Gunfight.
Gunfight, yeah. And I had to run 3.5 blocks to my getaway car afterwards. Okay? Like, Man,
this is my news guy.
I mean, I didn't even feel like I knew I got hit. I knew, and I got hit twice. I got hit in the arm also, but I knew I was hit, but like I didn't know where or how bad. And we drove out of Minneapolis right away because the one thing I knew is I didn't want to be in the same hospital as anybody else involved in the shooting. And so we drove to Faribault, Minnesota, which is like an hour outside of Minneapolis before we stopped at a hospital. And so like, I didn't even know until an hour later, like what the extent of my injuries were.
You should have known right away when you first.
Because like, okay, you would think so, but where's it? Yeah, it hurt up in my gut. I thought I got hit in the, you know, like it hurt up in my gut area.
No, but the vocal cord should have given it away. Like,
no, dude, I sounded like a bullfrog. Actually, I was more like, oh my god, like I'm in shock, like. I sounded like that. It wasn't all, I got it more like this. It was like, oh my God, that was bad. You know, like, yeah. Wow. So.
Wow, that's already more severe than any of my worst injuries, man.
Yeah, that happened when I was 18. I was like.
18, like I sat on a light bulb when I was 14, and that doesn't even compare.
No, it doesn't. So yeah, so the Big Bay broadcast. Now you're on Roku. Now you're not on. Are you still on YouTube or are you just
no?
On...
We're now audio only, and we're on the podcast playground, which is owned by Shaquille O'Neal, and they were on anywhere you listen to podcasts, anywhere: Google, Audible, Spotify, Apple. We're everywhere right now. So
you said owned by Shaquille O'Neal.
It's owned by Shaquille. Yeah.
Shaq is a great business person.
Well, I never heard of a podcast playground until just 5 seconds ago, so I don't know. I don't know how great.
But he's involved in so much.
It's also owned by Quentin Tarantino. Maybe that's why he did
it. Now I'm mad. Now I'm really mad.
He's not even going to promote it now. He's like, Quentin Tarantino. No.
Once Upon a Time in Hollywood has the most epic performance ever by Brad Pitt. He is amazing in it. You didn't see that?
No. That's pretty good.
Oh, God. He's so funny.
I'll be perfectly honest. After Pulp Fiction, I threw my arms up and said, this is a stupid fucking movie.
My friend's in
Pulp Fiction. So have you even seen Inglourious Basterds? Have you seen this movie?
No. It's so good.
Oh, my God, bro. Bro, it's so good.
I tell you, I stopped at Pulp Fiction because it was a stupid fucking movie.
My friend got famous from Pulp Fiction. So,
bro.
No, I got famous for Reservoir Dogs, right?
Huh? My friend plays Maynard, the pawn shop owner.
Maynard, the pawn shop owner.
Yeah, the guy, you know, if you
sold the watch. He sold the watch that ends up in the guy's ass.
So much worse. It's so much worse than the watch. If you actually,
whoa! Are you okay? So you're saying your friend is the dude? Friend is Zed? No, Maynard. Who's Maynard?
Maynard is the guy who owns the pawn shop. Calls up Zed after he captures Bruce Willis.
Right. Okay, so Maynard's the dark high guy with the beard, and Zed was the blonde.
Yeah, Zed.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah. Oh my God. For real, dude, that's so fucking awesome. Yeah, that's fucking man.
Now you're impressed by that.
That's the most badass scene of the whole fucking movie. You know what I mean, dude? When Bing Rames gets up with that fucking shotgun, you're just like, yeah, you done fucked up, didn't you? You know what I mean? Like, you're just thinking, like, y'all fucking bitched out the wrong motherfucker, dude.
I'm fucking far away from being okay.
Yeah, I'm pretty fucking far away from being okay. Yeah, fuck yeah, fuck yeah.
On my Facebook memories today, there is a post from last year where Craig,
a year ago
this today. Craig, posted, Matt is right, in bold letters. It was one of these things. When that happens, as far as your awakening, because he was thinking, I don't know what I'm talking about with the Mets. He's a Met fan, and he kind of was, oh, Matt, you don't know what you're talking about. And then last year on this date, he said, Matt is right.
Right.
When that happens with the Quentin Tarantino thing, now I'll be dead, but will you guys come to my grave and write on my tombstone, I'm not going to have a tombstone, on my ashes, on my urn, wherever I am, just write, Matt was right. That's all I'm asking. When the revelation hits you that you've been,
but you were right about the Mets. You're wrong about Quentin Tarantino.
You know what we'll do? We'll rent a plane to do one of those banners around LA. It'll just fly around Los Angeles and it'll say Matt Napo was right. Quentin Tarantino sucks.
That works for me. That works for me.
I don't see that he sucks. I'm sorry. It's.
I mean, I don't know. They probably charged by the letter. Can we shorten Quentin Tarantino to QT sucks? Is that okay?
Yeah, QT sucks.
And we'll put a picture on it.
And he does a lot of revisionist history, but his movies are damn entertaining.
I know that's
dead, baby.
Listen,
exactly.
We can debate on whether popularity is a good qualifier to judge for merit, because we can go by Nickelback, we can go by Millie Vanilli. Millie Vanilli was a huge hit.
Bro,
popularity doesn't always equate to quality. The American public, or the worldwide public for that matter, is not a good judge of merit.
No, I agree. Well, Matt, let me ask you though. You just mentioned it. Do you like Nickelback?
No.
Really?
I don't hate them. I'm not a Nickelback hater. I would never say, you know what? I got a hankering to listen to some Nickelback.
Well, no, I mean, I jumped on the bandwagon. I really hadn't heard them, and I was making Nickelback jokes. And my friend goes, "You really? Did you ever hear?" And he sent me a song to listen to, and it rocked me out. I loved it. I'm like, okay, I'm going to take this back. I'm not going to make fun of Nickelback anymore.
No, I can understand you not thinking they suck. Again, I don't hate them, but when was the last time you just like you're laying in bed and you're thinking, I got to hear some Nickelback today.
Hang on, are there bands that you do feel that way about?
That's actually Aaron Rodgers now. He's not a quarterback, he's a Nickelback at this point.
I'm sorry,
he had some of that southern twang going on during that game. Holy
shit. I think that was a southern twinge actually in his Achilles.
I still think it's like a nightmare. I actually watched that game going, this can't be happening.
Dude, I mean, for
I'm
real,
a
that's
a fan and a Jet fan. So I'm getting fucked on both ends at this point.
I thought that's how you liked it.
Hey! What's the coming to go?
How long till they retire Aaron Rodgers' number?
Because it's bad luck and it's jinxed.
Now, he's old enough that he's not even planning on ever coming back, right? Or is he going to come back next year?
Dude, there's no way.
I find it, I don't think it's...
Dude, Ryan Howard on the Phillies was 31. He tore his Achilles, came back a year and a half later, and was not the same person and had to retire. That's a 31-year-old man. He's going to be 40 in less than 50 days, Aaron Rodgers. I don't see how he comes back. And I think he'll try, but I don't. I really.
I mean, why would you want to, though? You know what I mean? It's not like he didn't prove himself. It's not like he didn't have a great career. You know what I mean?
I'll give you an answer to that. You don't want your legacy to be, oh, he paid 4 minutes for the Jets and then fucking retired after an injury. That's what's going through his mind today. Maybe not as time goes on, he'll probably forget about that. But who would want to be, have that be your swan song?
Right. But I mean, I'm sure Peyton Manning didn't want like his last season to be what it was in Denver, because it's not like that was
sure season. He don't want to be a last season, but not last 4 minutes. Yeah, I got paid $75 million for 4 minutes.
Dude, with all the pregame show for 2 hours was Aaron Rodgers, Aaron Rodgers, Aaron Rodgers. Here's a snap. He's out for the year.
Yeah. I mean, I'm
devastated by it, man. I feel like I'm still thinking I might be in a coma somewhere.
Now we are doing a football picks on Friday. This is a new thing we're starting. Football picks. Nice. Willie and I are going to do our picks against the odds.
I'll take Nickelback.
I'm going
to. Are we going to do it on Friday or on Thursday? Because there is a Thursday game.
Yeah, there is.
Maybe we should do it tomorrow. Tomorrow's Thursday. I see. That's how fucking out of it I am. I wasn't even thinking of that Thursday as part of this weekend. Yeah, so I guess we need to do it tomorrow.
Do you know?
As part of my picks, I'm going to pledge this, and you know that I know everything about sports now. This has been established.
He is the Oracle.
I'm going to pick the Jets every week until they every week, and they're going to win the Super Bowl this year. That's what I'm going to say right now. You can go to mybookie.com. Oh, look, he got that, scared him away. That actually scared him off the planet. It
scared me too.
I forgot. Yeah, you believe that this is like a destiny year for this backup, right?
Right.
What if Zach Wilson does become the greatest quarterback, and now Aaron Rodgers wants to come back, and he's got the contract?
Have you seen Heaven Can Wait, directed by the fabulous Quentin Tarantino?
And are you aware of what happened between Tom Brady and Drew Bledsoe?
The remake that Quentin Tarantino put out last year, Heaven Can Wait. You haven't seen it, right? Because it tanked. It was Quentin's remake of Heaven Can Wait. You know I'm lying right now.
Yeah, I don't think that's the thing.
I don't think that happened.
I love that movie still to this day.
Quentin did too.
He did. Well, he's got good taste. It's a good movie. It's a fun movie.
Anyway, that's what I'm thinking is going on with this Zach dude. I'm thinking he's having his moment of destiny, and this is going to be as part of my picks. Now, we'll keep a record on who does best, but I'm pledging that I'm going to stick with the Jets. And you know me, how loyal I can be. I never flip-flop on these things, Craig. So I'm going to pick the Jets every week.
I can see my post a year from today. Matt was almost right.
Well, and here's the other thing about that. You can go on mybookie.com/minddog and bet your Super Bowl picks today. And if I'm urging everybody, go to the bank, take out all of your savings, all your checking, put it on the Jets for the Super Bowl.
Do you know who I think is going to win the Super Bowl this year?
The Detroit Lions?
Not yet, but they look good. I think the Cowboys are my favorite to win so far. I mean, look what they did to the Giants.
They did blank the Giants 40-0 at home.
But to be fair, so did my sister.
Hey! Man, you're on it today, Matt. You're on it today. I love it.
I mean, that was like, the Dallas Cowboys played like they were Quentin Tarantino's Cowboys. That's what they
right.
Not everywhere.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. Now transitioning, we got to say goodbye to Govs. By the way, that's what I.
Bye, Govs.
My Governor's podcast. Support them. Go to govs.com. Find out who's playing. Now, Craig's good friend, his best friend in the whole world, is Gary Valentine. I don't know if you know that. Craig and Gary have a long friendship.
I've known Gary for 40 years.
Right. Well, he's at Govs this week.
Gary's hilarious. Go see him. Oh, my God. He's great.
Now, you were friends with his brother as well, or know his brother, right?
I was closer to Gary than I was to Kevin, but I knew Kevin. I can tell you a story about the first time I worked with him.
No, unless it has something to do that would really piss him off and like make him feel like you're bashing him. We don't want to hear it. We want to hear like negative.
You're not a Kevin James fan?
No, I don't really. I'm not a mall cop fan, but I don't have really. I don't really. I'm just looking for to create controversy. And if Kevin James found out that somebody was bad mouthing on here, somebody he knew from the past and got upset about it enough to get me some attention, it would be worth it, even if it ruins your life.
When Kevin James was considering being a stand-up, he was in the audience at a Ground Round or a Chili's I was working at, and I said something about his girlfriend, and they had to stop him from beating the shit out of me.
Oh, that's good enough.
Yeah.
So the story we're going to spread on the internet today is that Kevin James was heckling Craig, and Craig beat the piss out of him in front of everybody at the Ground Round.
I say here comes the boom. I think the opposite would be true.
Why can't you just go with me on this?
Well, because I don't want to die. And because Kevin has long.
You
Kevin
would not die for. Tentacles. Now, you're not a good friend. You're telling me you would not die to improve my ratings.
Absolutely.
Willie would take a bullet for me right now, right?
He already did. He lost a nut. Come on, seriously.
That's right. That's right. They ain't going to hit that other one. Ain't no way. Yeah, ain't no way somebody's got that good aim. You don't even know which one's missing.
Yeah, he wears cold underwear, so they stay close to his body now. Seriously.
That's right. That's right. Actually, my wife got me this new underwear that's got like it's almost like a cup. It's got like a V cut. It like cups your scrotum. And I was like, babe, I got all this extra scrotum. This doesn't work for me. Like it's not
extra scrotum.
Yeah, because like, bro, I get bat wing like nobody's business. You have no idea.
You want to hear Gary Valentine's story then?
Yeah, but first I want to go to Outback and order some extra scrotum with that.
That's on the menu there. That is
Gary
on the
Valentine,
menu.
Who is hosting a showcase type of night at Governor's this weekend. We're about to hear a story that doesn't include scrotum. I think it doesn't include.
No, it does not. Well, almost. But I wonder if Gary remembered this, but when he was first starting, Rob Graydon and Steve Strand show were doing a show at Betty's Fireside. And if you did any kind of comedy on the East Coast in the 80s and 90s, you know that Betty's Fireside was literally the worst club on the face of the planet. It was like being a gladiator and everybody was against you. I mean, it was one of the worst gigs ever. People yelling and screaming, not paying attention. It's a stripper bar, so you're on that little horseshoe above the bar. That's where you performed. It was horrible. And Gary came along with us because we were going to try doing some improv. I don't know even why we...
At a strip gig?
I'm serious. Well, there wasn't a strip. There was no strippers that night. So we're driving...
Right.
He had white baseball pants on, right? And Rob goes to him, oh, white pants, man, watch out. You're going to have bloodstains on it. And we laugh. Well, it so happens that during our desperate attempt... Our desperate attempt to do improv, he fell and skinned his knee, and he had a big blood stain at the end of the night on his knee. And we said, see, we told you were going to draw blood. And, that's my story about Gary. He was...
I thought it was going to be tied into scrotum. And then when you said blood, I was certain there would have been scrotum blood on the pants.
Scrotum blood?
Scrotum.
It might be. We don't know. He didn't reveal that. It could have been his knee. Could have been his scrotum. We don't really know. You'll have to ask Gary when you see him at Governor's.
Scrotum Blood is a great punk rock band out of New York City, by the
that's
way.
A great very name.
Good. Very good.
Dude, stuff. That would be a great band name. I'm not. I mean, that's a punk rock game. Scrotum Blood.
I think it would be a band leader's name, like, you know, the lead singer of Spinal Bifida is Scrotum Blood.
Spinal Bifida, no.
You never saw Spinal Bifida? They were great.
Is that a real band?
No.
Okay.
There was a band called Acid Bath that was really popular in Sioux Falls. Acid Bath, that was kind of a cool band.
Yeah, Butthole Surfers were an eye-opener for me. Hey, one eye-opener, a spider eye-opener for
me. By the way, I'm actually having coffee with the dog.
Oh, have you tried Mind Dog coffee?
No,
my phone's about to die, so I'm going to jump off here so I don't just abruptly leave.
All right, jump off. We're about to wrap up anyway. It's coming up. Now, I'm going to just, you don't have to jump off. I'm going to pop you off. Pop off.
Oh,
there he goes. Let me change our background here. I appreciate you getting up early this morning. Now, this week, Big Bag Broadcast, who do you got on this week?
Jim Labriola. You've seen him in the Santa Claus, the movie, and also on Home Improvement.
Also
in a comic.
Yeah, so now, if you mention all these people that you know, why not get Gary Valentine on there? That would be a good... Can you? Could have you reached out to him? I mean, if I were you and I've had all these, interactions with people at comedy clubs, I would be reaching out to everybody. Are you just shy? What's the deal with you?
Well, no, we had Joey Cole on. We had Patty Rossborough on. We have Wendy Liebman on. All these the thing with Gary is I honestly haven't talked to Gary in 35 years. It's kind of tough after 35 years to go, hey, man, you want to do my show? Click. Hello.
Wouldn't be for me. I'll call him. Give me his number.
We had Rock Rubin. Rock Rubin was on. Rock was the head writer on King of Queens. We had Rock on. So, sometimes, you know, I don't want to be like.
Now, those people, that was a click. The Kevin James Romano click.
Yeah, it definitely was. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So what about people like Andy Kindler and all the,
I don't know him. I don't know him. But
you don't know Andy Kindler?
No.
Whoa.
I know John Manfredotti. I worked with him, big Met fan. So he'd be on the Matt Napo bandwagon.
Now, those guys were all Met fans. Romano, yes. James, all of them guys are Met fans. Right? They would hate me. None of those guys would ever do my
show.
They have
to get you. They would get you. Come on. I get you.
Well, you know, I got death threats from Met fans this year.
Not real ones, though.
No, real ones.
No, it was
the guy actually came after me with a knife. He had to have his own security team stop him because I said the Mets suck.
What? You
know, on Facebook.
Was it Steve Cohen?
No, it was the guy from the meatball place in Patchogue, who the studio I was working for was doing some work for him, and he decided to follow me. And he saw me bashing the Mets, and he got, you know, bashing the Mets, doing what I do, just busting balls. And he got really upset about it, and he was coming on my page and, like, you know, starting shit with me. And I was like, why are you starting shit with me? And then before you know it, he's texting me, sending me private texts about, you know, with all these threats and stuff. It's like, yo, dude, calm down. I'm fucking joking about the Mets. I said, you know what? To be honest, I was a Met fan from 1962 until 2008, I was a Met fan, and then I stopped being a fan altogether, and now I'm just kind of busting balls on the Mets. But if you're going to get here, serious about this stuff. So I was playing at a place four doors down from his establishment on a Sunday, and he found out he was coming down. He made a threat that he was going to kill me. He made an effort to do it. They had to call the cops. His own security force had to, his own security guys, his bouncers and stuff, had to stop him from coming down the street to stab me.
Jesus Christ.
He got arrested for it. And then the next day, he got arrested for fighting with his Uber driver. So there you go. I tied it all together.
Met fans don't want to face the truth. And you saw it. Even though you were busting, I think you saw it.
Yeah.
And I really love what they've done, because you know what? What I love about that, they said, oh, we got these two old pitchers. This isn't going to work. Let's just make a 90. Let's do a 180. And they did. And I'm like, good for them. Good for them. It's not like the Yankees are screwed right now.
Well,
they are. They have all these big contracts. They can't. I mean, now they're talking about unloading Stanton and all that stuff. I don't know. It's
all right. Let's because we just have a couple minutes here. Mets moves now. My brother is of the. He's like an old school Met fan. Like he was at opening day 1962.
Okay.
At the Polo Grounds.
Right.
He's of the opinion that everything starts and ends with pitching, and he's of the same ideology of me, is that they've ruined pitching completely with the pitch count and all this stuff.
I agree.
But he thinks the Mets are concentrating too much on getting home run hitters and guys who are and not that you don't need them. Of course you need hitters, but the Mets have always built their success on strong arms. I mean, this is what they're all about. And he's like, they're not doing that at all. Basically, they're either signing all, I know they just got rid of the two arms that they signed, but he's like, they're concentrating on the wrong kind of pitchers. We need to get, you know, a minor leagues full of like Sid Finch. The 112 mile an hour before anybody had ever thrown a 100 mile an hour fastball.
Yeah.
The imaginary
Sid Finch. 112, and he pitched barefoot.
Yeah. So what is your pitchers for the Mets future? Do they have?
They got Cody Senga, who's actually developed this year. He started off rocking. He's been very, very strong. I love Quintana. He's been a rock too. So you got those two.
Minor league. I'm talking about coming up.
Yeah,
stud pitcher.
You got Mike Vasil coming up. He only rates as a third or fourth pitcher. I'm trying to think who else they have. This kid Buto might be just a flash in the pan, but he's had three great good starts in a row. He could be somebody who could be a swing man. No, they definitely need to draft some superior arms. They really do. They don't have it right now. You're absolutely right.
They need organizational people who – and you know what? The first team that gets this, it's hard to buck trends. But the first – because I don't know if it was Torrey's Yankees that started this idea of a six-inning game. You know, back in the 90s when they had what was the other guy? When Mariano Rivera was still a setup guy. He wasn't
when they had John Wetland.
John Wetland, yeah. But so the idea behind baseball has become a six inning game where nobody wants to even think about complete games anymore. The first team that starts to train their kids to throw 7,000 pitches in a season.
How about this kid Kirby? This guy, what was his name? George Kirby, I think his name was.
George Kirby.
The pitcher on one of the teams. They took him out. Yeah, they took him out and they put him back in the sixth inning. He was at 90 pitches. And he goes, you know what? I was done. I'm really upset that they put me back in because he gave up two home runs to tie the game.
Right.
And he was really upset that he said, I was 90 pitches. I was done.
It's mentally and physically conditioning yourself to throw 135 pitches a game.
Tom Thibodeau would be spinning in his grave at this guy.
Nolan Ryan, I believe, and don't quote me on this because, you know, I get stats wrong all the time, but I believe he threw like 135 pitches in a complete game, and 3 days later, on 3 days rest, threw 150 pitches in the next game.
And more. I think he went as high as 170, 180. Somebody said 230, but I think that's almost impossible.
And I love the old pitchers duels that went 14 innings with the starting pitchers still in. You know, Seaver against Marichal. Yeah. I'm old.
No. It's the Mets don't have that, but they are loading up their farm system. And the current talk is they may trade Alonso, and that would break my heart because I really love power hitters.
I know you love him, but do you think there's any validity? Because I do. I definitely think there's some validity to the idea that he
for him. Yes.
Yeah. He just needs to grow up. Somebody, and I blame Showalter. It always comes down to the leadership. The leader needs to be able to say, I don't care how much fucking money you make. I don't care how many home runs you hit. You got to adjust your attitude. You got to become more of a team player, more or less of a poisonous effect on the team.
Well, with Buck Showalter, it's kind of a slippery slope because I like him as a manager, but I also have a crush on him. So they better not get rid of him.
That, you know what? You really need to.
Yes, I really need help. I know.
Yeah, no. Anyway, that's it for today. Off the cuff, you can get a sneak peek at what is it? Offthecuff.com.
Just go to www.offthecuffwithcraigmitchell.com. This Sunday, September 17th, you get to see the entire first episode of season 6.
What's the dish? What are you cooking?
I'm making low carb fish and chips.
Low carb fish and chips.
Really?
Now fish don't have any carbs to begin with.
No, but the breading does. So I did, and I don't use for the chips. I used jicama.
You what? You pickle nuts? What? You pickle your nuts?
Jicama.
Oh.
Jicama. I use pickle nuts because you know what? Nuts. Pickles have nuts, and then
or you could pickle your own nuts, and while you're doing it, just to giggle. I don't know.
You'll have a just get some brine and dip it. I don't know. I'm making fish and chips. It's good.
Well, good luck with the new season. I hope you can continue to grow your audience and grow your success. We'll talk to you again. Thanks for getting up early and being part of this. And have me on Big Broadcast again. I expect an invite to come very shortly.
You're in.
Back on.
Thank you.
Have a great day, great morning, and enjoy the beautiful California sunshine. Bye for now. Craig Mitchell, Off the Cuff Cooking with Craig Mitchell. And look forward to this season, especially if you like to pickle your nuts. I'm getting some really weird text messages here. I'll check them out in a minute. Anyway, that's the show for you today, folks. I hope you enjoyed that. I'd love to know what you think. Do you care about the Lewinsky stuff? And not just the Lewinsky stuff, but the book main premise about how important it is for the Secret Service not to get political, because we see that right now playing out where Secret Service does seem to be playing favorites. And, you know, we can't have that. You can't have a Secret Service or anybody working in an administration that is not on board with blind loyalty is a whole other thing. We don't want them to be too loyal to a president or a chief executive, but we don't want them to turn a blind eye either. So how important is that? Do you care about that at all? You're going to read the book. What's your takeaway? Write to me at info@minddogtv.com, info@minddogtv.com. Mentioned Mind Dog Coffee. Craig was drinking coffee there. We didn't sell him pitch hard enough on Mind Dog Coffee. Go to minddogtv.com/shop, and you can pick from a lot of gourmet blends. Some people complaining already of that. It's too expensive. $13.95 is where we start for a 1 pound bag of, I believe that's the cowboy blend. But we have also, you can get your individual samples too. Those one cupper things that my wife likes, those make one cup at a time of all variety of blends. That's a cheaper way to go. But hey, listen, gourmet specialty coffees are not going to be as cheap as your off the shelf, you know, whatever your supermarket brand is. It's just not, but it's better coffee. Trust me on this. You got to trust me. I know coffee. I know the Mets suck. I know good coffee. Take my word on that. Tomorrow, who do we have tomorrow, folks? You know what? I've had a cancellation for tomorrow. I was supposed to have a comedian on tomorrow who has had to, it was Glenn Tickle, who has a new special coming out, but he had to, he had an emergency situation, so we're going to have to reschedule him. I'm not sure who I have on tomorrow. So we'll find out when we get here, I guess. But Willie and I will probably be doing football picks. And as I mentioned, you could go. I'm going to be taking the Jets no matter what this week, because I'm pledged to take the Jets throughout the season. I do think, listen, I'm never wrong about these things. So get on board. Go to mybookie.com/minddog and place your bets on the Jets now. You can just do that now, no matter what the odds are. And bet the ranch. Bet your entire, your house, your mortgage, your entire life savings on it. Don't blame me when shit goes wrong. Anyway, that's the show for today. Thanks for coming. Get yourself some Mind Dog coffee. And we also have merch. Don't forget the merch that's available. T-shirts, cups, non-toxic dildos, all those kind of things. I should have mentioned that to Craig, too, come to think of it. Anyway, turn on your radio. I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks for coming. Bye for now.
me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now.